हेलो एवरीवन, सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विथ अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट सब्जेक्ट्स लेक्चर सीरीज एंड दैट इज इंडियन पॉलिटी एंड कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन एट वर्क. सो वी विल बी हैविंग सेपरेट क्लासेस फॉर इंग्लिश मीडियम स्टूडेंट्स एंड सेपरेट लेक्चर्स फॉर हिंदी मीडियम स्टूडेंट्स विल ऑल्सो बी अवेलेबल. दीज लेक्चर्स आर गोइंग टू बी वेरी बेनिफिशियल फॉर वेरियस स्टूडेंट्स हु हैव बीन प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर CGPSC एग्जाम, CG व्यापम एग्जाम्स, एंड इट इज ऑल्सो गोइंग टू बी वेरी यूजफुल फॉर UPSC एस्पिरेंट्स. The topic which we will be covering today, these are basically static topics. They don't change with time, so it is a one-time process. If you, abide by these projects, if you abide by these classes, you will be done with these topics, and they are very scoring too. They are also very important. So when we talk about today's Constitution of India, it has never been a one-day process. Okay, it has taken quite long time to evolve through. Our Constituent Assembly has put forth lots of effort to frame today's constitution. And even today's Indian political system is greatly influenced by our experience even before the pre-independence era. Okay, so as we all know, and if you guys don't know about it, so we have been under the British colonial rule before our independence. And the British colonial rule started with the advent of a European company which was called as East India Company. Okay, so we will be studying the constitutional development of India from the advent of East India Company, then how the British Empire took over the East India Company rule, and how today's constitution is somehow related to all these regulating acts, all these various British Government of India Act. So let's join in and let's all be ready to learn as much as possible. So let's begin with. As you all can see, this is all about the constitutional development of India. So okay, we are starting with the constitutional development of India. So the constitutional development of India can be traced back by various acts which have been enlisted over here. In order to memorize these acts, it's very important to get to know the technical meanings of these names as far as to split and learn. And I will tell you how to learn these things. So first of all, let me tell you, India's struggle for independence actually started from 1857's India's War for Struggle. So the revolution of 1857 was a landmark incident in the history of India, and this kind of has influenced the various acts, the various policy framing of the British Empire as well as the East India Company, which was ultimately taken over by the British Empire. So if we ask for the 1857's revolution, so this is 1857's revolution. So all the acts which are enlisted before the 1857's revolution come under East India Company rule. All these acts come under EIC rule. And all the below acts, whichever are written below it, they come under the Crown rule. Which Crown rule? The British Crown rule. Okay, so 1857's revolution divides these acts into two major categories, and these two major categories are EIC rule and 1857's revolution. Then comes the British Crown rule. EIC means East India Company's rule. Clear? So if we want to quote the East India Company rule, we need to start with the Regulating Act of 1773. The next point which needs to be noted, that it was decided that each act would be revised after each 20 years. Okay, so after a gap of 20 years, we'll be having a new act. But at times it has been seen that because of certain irregularities, because of certain modifications, few acts arrived beforehand. So first of all, we'll be learning all the acts which came after a duration of 20 years. So let's start with the Regulating Act. Regulating Act of 1773, followed by the Charter Act of 1793. Leave this Fitz India Act for a while, okay? Then after 20 years, it comes to 1830s Charter Act. Then after 20 years, this is 1833's Charter Act. Again after 20 years, that is 1853's Charter Act. Okay? This Pitt's India Act is something specific. And this act was actually brought to bring out certain modifications in the Regulating Act of 1773, which we will be covering in the upcoming class. And you will get to know what was the need of bringing this act. Okay? So I hope now these all things have been memorized before the 1857's revolution. Now let's come to after 1857's revolution, which quotes down the British Crown Rule. You might be seeing it clearly. So British Crown Rule takes the various acts, British Government of India Act 1858, followed by Council of India Act 1861, Council of India Act 1892, Council of India Act 1909, followed by Government of India Act 1919, then 1935. A standard time duration of 10 years was given in order to improvise these acts and bring out certain modifications and amendments in the preceding acts. Okay? So now we are starting with the Regulating Act of 1773. Before studying Regulating Act of 1773, it is very important to get to know about the background of Regulating Act of 1773. So this is a very interesting story, and this is something which has impacted India quite much. So it is time of 1599. There is a queen in England. Her name is Queen Elizabeth II. So Queen Elizabeth II, she has been approached by a group of merchants of England. They come to her and they ask that we want to trade in India. Because India was very famous for the spices. India was called as the golden bird. It had a rich cultural heritage. There was abundance of spices. There was very beautiful climate over here. Lots of money, lots of gold specifically from that time. So they came up to Queen Elizabeth II and they said that we are very much interested to come and trade in India. Queen Elizabeth II said, I am very supportive towards you. Go and, you know, grow. Go and grow. And I will not charge much taxations from you. On a very negligible taxation rate, Queen Elizabeth II, she permitted all these group of merchants to go to India and to establish their company. And famously, this company was known as East India Company. Because why? These merchants traveled towards East and appeared in India. Why? To trade. So their basic motto was to trade. But ultimately, in order to trade freely, gradually East India Company started having its own military. Gradually it became a political power. And as East India Company, over a period of time, started earning more and more money, started growing more financially, the British Empire was majorly concerned. British Empire never wanted to lose India because, as I told, India was a golden bird. So British Empire wants to have certain control over East India Company. Besides that, it was also said by British Empire that East India Company was not working well when it comes to the ruling part. Okay, the various employees of EIC were involved in bribes, were involved in corruptions and all these malpractices. So it was needed for them to take over their control over East India Company. Okay. So in order to establish that control over East India Company, the first act has been brought out by the British Empire. So the British Parliament passes down an act in 1773 in order to regulate the various functions of East India Company in India. And this act has been called as the Regulating Act of 1773. Okay, so this act is called as the Regulating Act. Why? Because the British Empire is trying to regulate the affairs of East India Company, which is kind of establishing its mini empire in India. All right, So after this Regulating Act of 1773, what is the significance of this act? The significance of this act is that this is the first act through which the British Empire established its control and regulated the affairs of EIC. The second important aspect of Regulating 1773 was that central administration was introduced in India. So what was the need of introducing central administration in India? So basically the need was that when we want to take the control of power from multiple dimensions, like East India Company has always been ruling over India for a long time, okay, and now the British Empire wants to take control from it. So what will British Empire do? It will do the centralization process, taking away of all the powers to a single individual, and that single individual would be representing the British Empire. Okay, so introduction of central administration came through the Regulating Act of 1773. So if we talk about the central administration, centralization policy of the British Empire in order to regulate EIC, how it works? So it can be very well understood by a graph. So for example, this is very this is something which I love doing, and it is very easy to understand via it. So if we make a graph, okay, and if we say this is the centralization process and this is the timeline. So the first step towards centralization was 1773, followed by the next step. The centralization is increasing, followed by the next step. It will be 1784, followed by the next step 1793, then comes the next step 1813, then comes the next step 1833. So 1833 was the final step through which the absolute centralization was achieved by the British Empire. Then comes the 1853's Charter Act. Okay, so from 1773 till 1833, we are going to observe via these acts that gradual centralization is occurring. Until and unless the British Empire takes the absolute control of the rule within the hands of a single person, centralization will continue. Okay, so introduction of central administration, then first time British gave right to control over Indian affairs. So this time British Empire is saying that, you know, now we have the control over all India affairs. This came into existence. Now the next point is Governor of Bengal was now called as Governor General of Bengal. So what does that mean? So that means the expansion of powers of the Governor of Bengal. So at that time India was majorly divided into three presidencies. Okay, so if you know, if we roughly take the map of India, so basically India was roughly divided into three presidencies. Which were they? One is the Bengal presidency, the other is the Madras presidency, followed by the Bombay presidency. Okay, so Bengal presidency was very important. Why? Because the then capital Calcutta was present in Bengal. It was the epicenter of various activities. It was very important. So now the Governor of Bengal was called as the Governor General of Bengal. His powers were increased, and Governor was technically the representative of the British Empire. So that's why they were increasing his power, so that he can establish his dominance over East India Company. Then it is very important to know who was the Governor General of Bengal. Who was the first Governor General of Bengal? He was Warren Hastings. He can also be called as the last Governor of Bengal or the first Governor General of Bengal. Okay. By this act, Bombay and Madras presidencies were brought under the control of Calcutta's Bengal presidency. So Bombay and Madras presidency was brought under the control of Bengal presidency. Via this act, Supreme Court of Calcutta was established in 1774, and the name of the CJI was, the Chief Justice was Eliza Impey. This is yet another portion where the questions are asked. Okay, so I hope I am clear. As we have been seeing that the power of Governor General were increased, his responsibility was increasing. So in order to assist him, a council was made, a group of people was created who would help him to carry forward his day-to-day affairs. And this council was called as Governor General's Council. Okay, so a Governor General's Council was created, which consisted of 4 members. So I hope we are done with the Regulating Act of 1773. Now we will be studying about the Regulating Act of, sorry, the Pitt's India Act of 1784. So here comes the Pitt's India Act of 1784. So what is Pitt's India Act? So basically, Pitt the Younger was the name of the then British Prime Minister. So the then British Prime Minister, Pitt the Younger, found that 1773 was not that effective. So in order to bring down further modification, Pitt's India Act was brought up. So the best way to understand what this act consisted of was lies in the meaning of pit. So as we know, what is the meaning of pit? Okay, so pit means to separate in a way. Okay, what does the pit do in a road? It separates the two sides. Similarly, the Pitt's India Act was brought to separate two things. Okay, and what are these two things? So basically, East India Company, his entire rule was bifurcated into two parts. One was the political rule, administrative rule, and the military rule on one side, and other was East India Company's commercial affair. So it has always been the British policy to divide and rule. Okay. So again, via Pitt's India Act of 1784, the British Empire is dividing East India Company into two parts. And what are these two parts? These two parts are political rule, administrative rule, and military rule on one side, and on the other side, the commercial affairs of East India Company. Now, what these people will do? These people, British Empire is going to take the absolute control of this part under themselves. How? Via a group of people, and this group of people would be called as BOC. BOC stands for Board of Control. BOC stands for Board of Control. So Board of Control would be responsible to regulate the political affairs, administrative and military affairs within India. Now, who will take care of the commercial affairs? The commercial affair would be taken care by yet another group, which would be called as Court of Directors. The Court of Directors would belong to East India Company, and this time East India Company will have the absolute control over commercial affairs. But one control has already been taken over by the British Empire. So this was the significance of Pitt's India Act. Okay, so you can refer to this slide, and this is very important. You need to memorize this aspect. Usually not much questions are asked in 1793's Charter Act, so we are not going through it. We will be covering the exam oriented class. Okay, now comes the Charter Act of 1813. So we already got to know the importance of Regulating Act, we got to know the importance of Pitt's India Act. Now comes the new word, charter. What does it mean? What does the Charter Act mean? Charter means sets of rules and regulations. So charter stands for sets of rule and regulations which will be given by the British Empire. For whom? For East India Company ruling in India. Okay, now Charter Act of 1813 was the next step towards centralization by British Empire within the Indian territory. So what all happened during Charter Act of 1813? Let's come to know that. okay? So Charter Act of 1813, what did it do? So initially East India Company was the only company which was authorized to trade in India. This is called as monopoly of trade. But now via Charter Act of 1813, the other British companies, other British trading companies were allowed to come and trade within India. Point to be noted, only British companies were allowed to trade in India, nobody else. So why did this was brought up into action? In order to decrease the commercial dominance of East India Company within Indian market. So via Charter Act of 1813, trade monopoly of East India Company within India was ended. But East India Company still was given trade monopoly over two items. What was that? Trade monopoly was given to East India Company for trade with China. So only East India Company could trade in China, and this was specifically mentioned in 1813. The major trade was of opium at that time. Second, tea trade. So tea is a commercial crop, and Indian plantation were bearing very good quality tea production. Okay, so that's why East India Company was retained with monopoly of trade with China and tea trade. This was the yet another important aspect covered in 1813's Act. Now, what is the yet another remarkable aspect of 1813's Charter Act? The Act also empowered the local governments to tax people subject to the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. It gave more power to the local bodies. Okay, so 1813's Charter Act empowered the local bodies for self-government. That is also very remarkable. The Charter Act of 1813 asserted the Crown's sovereignty over British possessions in India. Next, the company's rule was extended for the another 20 years. Next, this act granted permission to Christian missionaries. So this is a very frequently asked question. By which act Christian missionaries were granted the permission to come and preach Christianity? So it is 1813's Charter Act. Okay, you can just go through these presentations, these slides, and you can memorize your concepts. Now we will be moving on to the another Charter Act, and that is the Charter Act of 1833. So in 1813's Charter Act, we already saw that partially, like 70%, East India Company's trade monopoly was ended. Now it comes to Charter Act of 1833. So by Charter Act of 1833, the trade monopoly of East India Company was absolutely ended. Even when it comes to trade with China, and even when it comes to tea trade, the trade monopoly was ended for East India Company. Okay, and this was the final stage of centralization, the final stage via which British Empire has taken away all the powers from East India Company and has reduced it to just a mere body. Okay, so we can see that final steps towards centralization in British India. This was one of the important aspects of Charter Act of 1833. It ended activities of the company as commercial body, which became purely administrative body. So now East India Company was just reduced to an administrative body, which was absolutely dependent for the funds on the British Empire. Okay. Next, right to govern for next 20 years. Again, 20 years extension happened. Governor of Madras and Bombay were deprived of their legislative powers. As I told you, this is the final step towards centralization. That's why the governor of Madras and Bombay, they were deprived of the legislative powers. And as we have told again that extreme centralization is happening during Charter Act of 1833, the Governor General of Bengal becomes the Governor General of India. So now the Bengal's Governor General is not the Governor General of Bengal only. Now he is called as the Governor General of Absolute Indian Territory. And the next question which comes on, which keeps on occurring, that is, who was the first Governor General of India or who was the last Governor General of Bengal? So he was William Bentinck. So William Bentinck was the person who was the first Governor General of India or the last Governor General of Bengal. Okay, we have already written that point over there. So I hope we are clear with the Charter Act of 1833. Now we will be going to the Charter Act of 1853. Charter Act of 1853. So now the absolute centralization has already occurred. This is the background, okay? So now the absolute centralization has already occurred in 1833's Charter Act. Now what British Empire needs to do? Now in order to administer easily and systematically, the power needs to be allotted to another bodies, to another people, so that they assist in administration of such a huge Indian territory. Okay, so by Charter Act of 1853, we can see that a gradual process of decentralization has already begun. Why? Because now British Empire has already reduced East India Company as a puppet in their hands. Now the power is in their control. So now they will designate the administrative sectional powers. They will allot the portfolio system to their employees. So, Charter Act of 1853, the first provision is that for the first time it separated the legislative and executive functions of the Governor General's Council. So, you have already studied that a Governor General's Council was created in order to assist the Governor General. And now, Bengal's Governor General is not just Bengal's Governor General. Instead, he is the Governor General of entire India. So, he has lots of work. So, now his council was separated into two parts, one which would carry out the legislative process, the law-making process, and the other one which would carry out the law implementation process, which is called as the executive functions. Second, it established a separate Governor General's Legislative Council, which came to be known as the Indian Legislative Council. Okay, so this Indian Legislative Council, that kind of similar body at the center, still exist. Okay, so we can absolutely see that in the center we have a parliament. So similar to that body, Indian Legislative Council was established. So these were the major provisions of the 1853's Charter Act. The last point, the legislative wing of the council functioned as a mini parliament, which we have already covered, adopting the same procedures as the British Parliament. So today we are done with the various acts which ultimately lead to the formation of the present day Indian political system. And we have covered all the major acts which happened before 1857's revolution. In the upcoming class, we will also be covering the post 1857's revolution's various acts. So keep revising, keep studying, all the very best. Thank you so much.